I mean, good evening, not good morning. It's, please.
If you want to take anything home, please do.
Okay. Can you hear me fine? It's okay. Okay. Everybody can hear me fine? Yes, I guess so. So my name is Ale Contenti. I'm originally from Italy. I came here to the States in 2000, and it's a bunch of time ago, you know. And I came to work for Microsoft actually in this building, and I got lost in the parking lot. And but then I found the car eventually, the rental car. And you know, I started working in Visual Studio, and I still work in Visual C++, I mean, after all these years, and I'm the dev manager there. And under me, I have some, like half of the development team where we do the front-end compiler, we do the libraries like STL, ATL, or the new parallel libraries. We do the IDE with the project system and the intelligence, and we do the new graphics debugging tools. So that's about me. I'm glad to be here. Thanks for inviting me. And today I want to talk about, you know, something, you know, a little bit different from me. It's not just about C++, but it's like exploring a little bit the space of C++. And, you know, I'm always interested, usually when I'm not looking at bugs and shipping the product, whatever, how people use C++ and, you know, what are the boundaries, you know, the strange things they do with C++ that I don't expect. So my idea was actually, you know, to show it a bit. You know, I found one of these boundary points that was, you know, Cinder and, you know, graphics and, you know, prototyping and so on. And I want to show you a little bit what I learned while exploring that space. I'm not, you know, an expert, you know, in graphics or in DX and so on. So you can ask me questions. If I don't know, I won't answer them. But that's pretty much it. You know, so I think it's going to be interesting. And I also want to show you how, you know, Visual Studio, in my opinion, could be a good tool actually to explore these new spaces and, you know, to understand the code and play around with the code and so on. I'll also do a small pitch for VS 2013, that is the upcoming new release of Visual Studio. It's actually, you get a preview because it's going to be announced tonight at 4 a.m. I know you're all going to stay up until 4 a.m. to listen to the announcement, but you don't need to because I'm going to tell you about that. So this is the agenda, actually. I'm also about, you know, Visual C++. I'm one of the dev managers there, so I really want to tell you what we are about, what, you know, we believe in, and I hope you agree with me. A little bit of the upcoming features, and then, you know, I want to, you know, kind of, you know, go into this area, right? You know, I want to talk about Cinder and a little bit show you Box2D, really about, you know, how we can play around with these things. And on the same side, I want to show you how, you know, you can use Visual Studio to make this kind of experimenting a little bit faster or, you know, more agreeable, in my opinion. And then, you know, just feedback and, you know, QA and, you know, resources and so on. So so I made these very cool things up there. So I hope you appreciate. Yeah, it took me a long time. I thought it was easy. But, so these are, you know, one of the key things I care about in C++, in Visual C++, is really stay true to the core C++ values. You know, there are the performance. You know, you choose C++ for performance, for standard conformance, for cross-platform development. You want to pay for what when you play. You know, you just want to pay for what you choose to use, basically. Stability. The open C++ community, look at all the people, you know, in a certain sense. And, you know, the ability to go down to the meta. So one thing I noticed, you know, in my history, about like being the dev there or the dev lead, the dev manager, whatever, I notice that whenever we move away from these core values and we go a little bit that way or that way, you guys always get mad at us, always, right? You know, almost, you know, very precisely. So I don't want that. So I want to stay true to these things as much as possible, you know. And sometimes we go away, but we shouldn't. The other important thing for me is productivity, right? We are part of the Visual Studio suite, you know. I usually read, you know, Microsoft Visual C++ the other way around. So it's about C++. It's about being productive, you know, being part of Visual Studio, about, you know, discovery of the libraries and so on. You know, you understanding the code and better code debugging. Can you read this? Yes. And the other part is innovation, an innovation of the language. You know, not again in a Microsoft specific way, but, you know, bring back, you know, these innovation things to the standard, for example, like we are doing for async, that we are, you know, bringing the experience we have from C#, but bringing it back to the standard committee and actually making it a feature in the C++ standard eventually. And then, you know, they pay my salary, Microsoft. So we are part also of the Microsoft ecosystem. In the end, you know, we really want, you know, our tools to make you, to give you the opportunity to actually, you know, your application should be better and shine and use all the platform we have, the phones, the tablets, and Azure, and all these things. So this is my marketing pitch a little bit. They forced me to do that, no, more or less, you know. So, but, you know, these are kind of the new things we had in between 2012 and 2013. So in performance, we have, you know, auto-vectorization, vector calling convention, some improvement in C++ AMP, like shared memory support and then texture support. In graphics debugging, we is now, you know, part of VS Express, so you don't have to pay for it anymore. Just download VS Express, you have it. You can do remote capture, you can do compute shared debugging, and so on. So we will have also more details about this in our blog, and anything you want to ask me afterwards, just ask me or send me email, whatever. This is about the front end and the standard conformance in C++. You know, we added some features Herb talked about in going native and before a build, you know, MDMSI, a bunch of, you know, C++ 11, some C++ 14 things in lib, and a bunch of C99 things that, you know, we added them actually to be able to compile FFmpeg, that I think was a nice goal for us. You know, we really wanted to enable that open source library to be able to compile with our tools without too much duration and pre-passes to Clang and so on. So, about the cross-platform thing, we didn't do much to be cross-platform. When I mean cross-platform, I really mean to go not only across Windows platforms, like the phone and the tablets and Xbox and so on, but also about Linux and so on. But we did push out an open source library that is the C++ REST SDK, that is codenamed Casablanca. And you can download it and use it on Linux or on Windows, on different versions of Windows and so on, in the Metro version and so on. So, you know, this was kind of, you know, this could be an example on how I want to us to do more libraries or, you know, embrace more libraries. So open source, cross-platform when it makes sense, and so on. This is about the productivity thing. And so we did, a few things in the editor, like better code formatting. You can understand better and, you know, go back to definition or pick the definition ahead. The NuGet team did some support for, you know, NuGet for C++ for native. We had some, you know, channel 9 videos about that, blog entries about that. Better async debugging, better debugging in general, and interop debugging. And for the Microsoft ecosystem overall, we focused on the, you know, the 8.1 release. So we made it, you know, better for C++. We made it by default you are connected. So we leveraged the REST SDK we had. And so we, you know, you can automatically connect and your app. When you create a new Windows 8.1 app, you kind of get a server automatically ready for you. You can share information or data across. So this is about it for the pitch. If you need to know more, just ask me. You know, ask Eric. He's going to disappear soon, so you can't ask him anymore. So this is really a talk. No, he's the graphics again. No, I changed that. This really, I don't, is it clear what is this? This is all the C++ code in the world, right? This is it, you know. This is all there, right? It's a, in my opinion, you know. This is the idea that, you know, I want to show you, you know, and this is the boundary, the fringe, right? You know, I do believe that these things is always expanding, and, you know, like all of us, you know, most of the time probably we are here and we do our day-to-day job, but, you know, a few things maybe, you know, I don't know. I just saw the book about Kalman filters, right? I don't know. You know, are you stretching this out a little bit? I don't know. You know, sometimes, you know, you read, you explore something, or they tell you to do it, go do these things. Shit, what's that, you know? And, you know, it's interesting because the fringe is different also for different peoples. And to me, it's an important thing. So, you know, to me, for my job, I do a tool that I want everybody to use, a set of tools at least. I don't want probably everybody to use the same tool, but I'll try to, you know, a good design principle, usually they teach you to design something, you don't do for the median, right? You look at the old people, the very young people that, you know, have to pick up a tool, or, you know, you try to do a tool that, you know, stretches enough, and then usually the middle is taken care by that, you know? And so one example is very large project or incredibly small project, right? Can your tool stretch very well? I would argue that Visual Studio itself or Visual C++ doesn't stretch very well, right? It might be okay with a medium-sized project, but when you have a very small project, it's kind of a pain in the ass. There is a lot of things around that you don't care. And when you have a very large project, maybe we don't handle that very well. So I don't know, you know, complicated GPU and vector unit stuff, you know. But another boundary, in my opinion, is these graphics advertisement folks that they write stuff in C++ and they try, you know, I don't know, they do art stuff. They do art installment in New York City, and they do, you know, 100 iPads or surfaces. They are cheaper now, probably. You know, they attach them together, they attach some Kinects, and then you pass in front, and this is the advertisement for the next, I don't know, World Cup soccer, I don't know. Something that, you know, and these things you don't even think that they are going to make them in C++, but they do, right? So these are some just examples, right? These are not, sometimes are art installations, sometimes are, you know, application like this one is a famous iPad application done downtown in Seattle by paper, the, you know, the 53 people here. And, you know, they use, and of course, C++, and I'm sorry, this is kind of a little bit small, but, you know, it was an image. But the idea is that they use C++, they use things like Cinder or Open Frameworks that are these frameworks to prototype with their idea, to try their idea and to see if they work, and then they use them, then they throw away the prototype and they do it in production. Some people use Cinder in production, some people use their own frameworks, but we are, you know, sometimes, you know, we think about graphics just being like, you know, or DX just being for games or advanced things like that, but, you know, you can do a lot of strange and different things, so, you know. And, you know, when I think about experimenting and trying things, you know, I think about these keywords, you know, creativity, art, prototype, having fun, playing around with the things, you know, being inspired, and throw ideas in the screen. You know, for example, I was trying some of the demos I had yesterday with my wife, and I said, oh, do you like these, right? And she told me, oh, well, you should have some color, right? You know, and you add a little bit, and then you try this, and it doesn't compile, and then you try again. What the fuck is that? You check on the internet, and things like that, right? So the other side is this: what you think about this, your framework should be like that, in my opinion. It should be, you know, easy to access, intuitive to do the simple things, to do the more complicated things. You don't want the framework to limit you, right? So you want to have access to shaders and all the stuff if you really need them, or you can cheat a little bit if you don't need with a very nice JPEG or, you know, image and so on, right? You know, in general, you know, the community needs to be there, things need to be composable, like, you know, you can add the physics engine if you want and so on, right? And so these are, I had a couple of examples, right, about what you can do with Cinder. This kind of a word game that is for the iPad, of course, but, you know, it's very elegant, in my opinion. It's nothing very complicated. But, you know, but it's a complete game, and it's all done through Cinder, and, you know, nice transition and so on, some ideas and so on. And this is a famous app that, for example, even Herb talked about. It's Planetary. It's an app that is about, I think they're going to talk about it, you know, it's, it gets all your music, you know, database, and the artist becomes Sun. Yeah. Better accent than mine, bro. But the visuals are very nice, you know. So, you know, it's interesting. I really like it. It's very attractive, right? All these things and so on. There's a lot of prototype probably that went behind this. And so this kind of the idea of, you know, what it could be done, right? It's not just prototype and so on. You can finish the app, right? And you add some nice music. It always looks good. So these are kind of other examples, you know. Open Frameworks is being used by School of Design. Cinder's got, you know, some, you know, the advertisement industry, you know, a can, something like that. And Planetary, actually, the app we just showed, it was acquired by the Smithsonian. It's the first app that was ever, you know, acquired by a museum. So that's pretty cool. I think, you know, it feels almost that the boundary is not so boundary anymore, that something is changing, is becoming a little bit more mainstream. So something that we probably, that's why I wanted to explore it a bit more, and the rest of my presentation is really me kind of mocking around it a bit with Visual Studio and Cinder. So I suck at typing, so you have to bear with me, but, you know, I'm going to try and talk and tell you the story about, you know, what I learned and what I did, and, you know, so the first thing, I have my cheat sheet here. should do ask here. No. You go here and, you know, you go to libcinder and this, you know, if you go back here, you know, you can, these, you know, these are examples of the things you can do with Cinder. You know, if you, you can download, you know, the prepackaged version. But, you know, this version here are all based on OpenGL. And they don't work on, you know, I have a Surface. I think everybody has one right now. You know, so they don't work to write a Windows Store application, right? So I really want to do a Windows Store application. You know, another thing I want to do is, you know, I always write a little demos to try this and that, but I always do command line demos, right? I really love the command lines, and don't get me wrong, it's, I stay there a long time of my life. But, you know, I have these machines now, I can touch them, I can use the pen, I can use that. I feel I'm missing out a little bit. So I was attracted by these also to try out a little bit of these things. So actually, if you want to actually use the Windows Store version, you look for Cinder for Windows Store. You know, you can also use Google. It works. I checked. Actually, it's not the same order. But you go here, and it's kind of the first link. And, you know, it teach you, you know, from this DPE guy that is very, very passionate about this and so on, how to install Visual Studio, that you already have, blah, blah, blah. And you basically have to go to GitHub and basically get a special branch of Cinder that is the DX branch here. So. So if you go here, this is the repository. This is a DXRT branch that I have here. So I did it for you. I downloaded tons of shit, and you know, it's all here. Already I put it here. You know, document, GitHub. You know, there is all the include files. You know, different parts. There is some boost. You know, a part of boost is downloaded as well, and everything gets compiled into various lib files, basically, static libraries, and you know, there's also a bunch of samples and so on, right? So you get these, you compile all these, and then, you know, you can play with it, you know? And, you know, what I did, I just, what is this? This, not this one. I did, for example, this one. This is a very nice sample that comes with it, and let me play with it. The scene, so this one, you know, is just a particle, but, you know, you can do all these little things, right, you know? It's very nice, and you can add, you know, you can add gravity, so things fall down, and you know, other things, and so you know, it's a nice example of what you can do. Very, very simple. This is a very simple application, but you know, it doesn't use anything very complicated. But you know, you can see, you know, a little bit. For example, these are the images that they are using. They are simple images. They fake this blur effect with the images. And then, you know, when you look inside, you know, there's only, you know, the main thing here is the basic app. Oh, sorry. That has, you know, can you see? Oh, I should put it probably, put it bigger. Yeah. No way. Intelligence failed on me. I have a version that is not the final version, so if everything crashes here, it's not my fault. It's C-sharp or something like that, you know. Yeah, so basically the basic app is very simple, right? You know, you have some controls to control the mouse and the keyboard a little bit, but basically, you know, you set up your application, you create, you know, textures if you need or stuff like that, and the framework calls you to update, and then you draw something. And that's pretty much it, right? You know, you're setting the frame rate, for example, to set up your load in the two images I showed you before. You set up a font, and you know, and then when the mouse is down, you get the mouse position and things like that, right? You know. The mouse down, you can see these, you know, some key things to add, you know, floor, for example, and so on. This, the update thing is, you know, just updating basically the position of the particles and creating more particles, emitting more particles. And the draw things is, again, pretty simple, right? You know, you basically clear up the screen, you know, with a black color, and then you set up another color. And you emit, you basically render the emitter, you know, and one thing you could do is, you know, you could take a look about, you know, what is done here, right, you know. No, you just get the emitter images, you render the images, and then you unbind them. And you start rendering the particles, and you can take a look at what's inside the array, you know. And, you know, you start, you know, adding more particles and render them and so on, right? So I also use this example to show you a little bit, you know, how Visual Studio can be used to actually, you know, kind of, you know, peek inside the code and try to understand a little bit about the code, because you have kind of the intelligence there, you have the project there, you can go back and forth, you know. If you're really thinking about the code, now here I'm talking, but when you are by yourself, you don't, you know, really talk to yourself. You know, you're just there, you don't have to leave, you're really focused, right? You know, I like the idea that you can stay in the editor and stay focused about what you really try to do, right? You know. Now, okay, so let's say you understand this. I went very fast, right? Of course, you know. If you never seen Cinder, you get a little bit confused. But once you look at it for, you know, like half an hour, you figure it out, these basic things. But you want to, you just don't want to do the samples, right? You want to try, you know, you want to try things. And when you try things, I always create like a million hello world, right? You know, I do an hello world and I try, you know, a new features. Then I try another one. So when I, what I do for this, I want to streamline the creation of very basic new projects, right? So what I did actually, you know, I got all Cinder, because Cinder was here, you know, was it this include file, the lib file. And what you do, you usually have to change your paths to, you know, point to the right include and change the lib, and then you forget, you do it for debug and you want to compile and release and you forget and you redo it again, what a pain. So what I did, I copy all the files I needed, not the source file, just the H files and the lib file, and I put them in this extension SDK that I, what did I put here? And basically we have this folder under Visual Studio where you can throw your extension SDKs. There's basically, you know, a representation of a library, really, you know. And, you know, here under Cinder, you can put, you know, the version of Cinder. And in design time, we have debug and retail. And we have, you know, for x86, I put, and there is the lib. And the include files are, you know, in these are common configuration files. But anyway, this is just an example of how it could be easier, right, you know. And then what I did, I kind of got this sample, and I cleaned it up a little bit, and then I created an export template, so I created a new template. So if I do, you know, Control Shift N, basically, I create a new application. You know, I have this Cinder basic app that is a template I created like in 10 minutes, and I keep on using it over and over and over, right? You know, well, four times right now, but it's not 100, but you know, you get the point, right? So, you know, if you get this, you can, you know, this compiles, and I want to show you, for example, that. You know, if you look at references here, where is that? Are they here? Well, yeah, I always go here. Anyway. You know, if you look here, this is the reference I want. You know, I connected this project to this reference, and now all the include part and the lib part are set up for you. So you don't have to worry about that anymore. So one less thing to worry. You want to experiment. You don't want to worry about building and all the stuff, right? You know. Okay, so this compiles, and this doesn't do much, you know. It's deploying, blah, blah, blah. And this is a Windows Store app right now. Technically, you can get it, upload it to the store, make $1 million and retire. But, so it doesn't do much, you know, it just follows you. And it's very simple, you know. You can do it with a touch, and it's nice, right? But, you know, once I, you know, the first thing I think about, you know, I can do this with a touch, and, you know, I like pens, right? So I always, you know, try to use the pen when I can, you know. Another talk I had was about, you know, the journal things. I always try to redo the same things. So, you know, let's forget about these balls and these circle things and just try to use the pen, right? So I want to show you, you know, in a certain sense, we have something pretty simple again here. We set up, sorry, let me make it bigger. We set up and, you know, we check the mouse and we update and then we draw, right, you know. I think, you know, I don't need all this. I just need a bunch of, what I want to do is basically I want to draw and I want to connect all the points that I'm drawing about, you know. And, you know, we get a vector of points. And, you know, this we don't need. The setup, you know, well, the constructors work, so that's pretty good. You know, when the mouse moves, we don't need anything, I guess. And when the mouse drag, that means the pen is kind of on the screen. We want to basically, you know, this get pause, we want to push it back on the, not push back, not pop back. Something like that, you know. It should work. I'm sure something is not going to work, so, but you're going to be faster than the compiler is. So here, you know, what is the update? What does it do? Not much. The update shouldn't do anything at this point because, you know, we are just accumulating the points and there is no really modification we have to do on those points. We just have them there and, you know, we still want to clear up. You know, we can use white instead of, you know, black. And then, you know, this one we don't need. These guys we don't need, you know. Well, we can leave a color, you know. We can use black here. We use black, no alpha blending, because we just want black. But, you know, you could add that if you want and add other colors. And, you know, I think, you know, what we want to do is, you know, you want to begin basically drawing something. I think, you know, what do? I begin, I never remember. This kind of half OpenGL and half GF line, you know, line strip. There you go. Yeah, line strip. There you go. You know, and then, you know, basically for each point that is inside that point stuff, we are gonna probably just the X vertex, I guess. You know, we are gonna tell, you know, the Cinder to say, okay, use all these vertex here, and then, you know, that's pretty much it. And then, is it confused? Is it unhappy? Oh, no, it's okay. DX, and, you know, and this, you know, kind of, you know, I kind of draw, I think it should work, you know, there's no more squiggles, so it means it compiles, and, you know, let's just see. So this kind of should work, and we can use the pen and draw stuff around, you know. It was quick, right? You know, I didn't do anything special, okay, and it actually works, yes. It doesn't work perfectly, so it always tries to reconnect, so, you know, I guess you can modify it again, you know, and go back and add, you know, a set of segments here instead of, you know, we want to, you know, when I detach the mouse and when I put the mouse down again, I probably want to start a new, you know, I don't know, we can probably, instead of using vectors, we can use, you know, deck. It's not deck. This is a feature we should definitely do. But, you know, maybe these are not points. Let's call them segments. And, you know, maybe when we do a mouse down, we can add, you know, to the segments. We can, you know, we can push back, you know. I mean, I don't want to do it now, but it doesn't matter. You know? I think, you know, you get the point, you know. Basically, you know, you can add various arrays of things and, you know, you can draw more things, right, you know. Next things I want to show you is actually, you know, the integration with Box2D, right, you know. Box2D is another common open source framework that is used, for example, oh, please, yeah. Yes. That's weird, right? You know, when you, because you set up in the, you set up the begin end like there, right? You know, so yeah, I thought about that too, but you know, I think there are definitely other techniques that I don't know yet in Cinder to do that. But when you draw your frame, you don't want to be, you know, too confused by other threads, right? So probably all those threads, you want to synchronize them when you get to actually updating the frame, because you want to enter and do it pretty quick. If you have other things, maybe do them in update, but not in the draw. That would be my take. But, you know, don't take my word for granted, because I'm not a graphics guy, you know. You know, the game guys are going to give you the right answer here. And I'm not a game guy. I'm just a library compiler dude, right? A manager. I don't do anything. Even worse. But yeah, this would be the idea, right, to me. You know, really try to. That's why you have the update, and then you have the draw. You know, we didn't do anything in update here.
Yeah, but you cannot update from another thread than the UI thread.
Yes.
Or you figure out from the UI thread itself.
I don't think so. But you know, I wouldn't count on Cinder doing that. Yes. It's not Xamarin, right? You know. I want to talk about Box2D. Sorry. Box2D, who knows what Box2D is? Do you play with it? Physics engine, basically in 2D. You know, you throw a bunch. You have a world simulation. Actually, no, I have a sample. That's easier than me talking. You know, I have this test bed.
Is it Angry Birds?
Yes, Angry Birds is used in Box2D, yeah, and they're making a lot of money. They have this nice, you know, test. You can try a few things, you know. It's super cool, right? You have this, and then you can even, you know, drag things out and, you know, make them jump around and be bad, stuff like that. So when I saw this, I said, oh, I want to do it too, you know. I want to use this, you know. You know, it's, hey, you grab this one, this baby here, and I want to do it with my finger and stuff like that, right? You know, there's tons of samples here. These are just so fun. This is someone, I remember I saw something that looked exactly like Angry Birds, but I don't find it anymore, so I don't know where it is. But, you know, it's the, you know, I don't know, it's pinball. You can simulate the pinball, you know, stuff like that. And it's actually, I guess you had to restart. I don't know. How does it work? They do everything, right? It's all open source, you know, and I suck at pinball. Anyway, don't look at me. But anyway, so my point is that, okay, you get the sample, you know, you got compile the sample. Like here, for example, you look, I have the test bed and I have the PDB. I don't know where the sources are anymore. You know, I don't remember. I don't have the project. Maybe I have the source, but I don't have the project because I compile with mmake or make or whatever, you know. And another thing that's, to me, happens quite often, right? You know, I usually build some things and I have the PDB, or I build with a CL or a build.cmd or whatever. And, you know, then it's a pain in the ass to actually get IntelliSense. So what I want to show you is a new, if you do open new project solution, it's kind of an addition on top of Visual Studio. You have to download something from the web and so on. But if you go and look for, you know, just the PDB, you know, you just open the PDB, right? Yes, yeah, I don't want to say. And there is this PDB generator that basically, in the PDB, we put all the files, right? You know, Terry should know everything we put there. But, you know, we put all the files, and so we just say, okay, fine, you know, I like this. It finds all the files. They are actually build them on this machine, right? They are not on a remote machine. But you could map them if you have. And basically, you know, it generates, you know, a VCX project from that. And you basically have all the sources with all the IntelliSense working at this point, you know. You know, I really like, for example, that tile example, but I don't know where it is. And I found it here, right? I'm doing find all references, and I found the tile file right here, right, you know, just from the PDB. I didn't have to care about how I build all these things. I can build them one at a time, and so on. So I think this is interestingly powerful, right, you know.
You had another version of the version hell.
Yeah.
You have 20 of these lying around, you have to extract all the sources out of them, figure out which one's which.
Yes, you mean, we had 20 PDBs?
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, you're right. That's true, you're right. Because, you know, the PDB is not associated with the X. You're not 100% sure it's the same one. But I guess you can, it's pretty easy to match an X with a PDB because the debugger does that, right? You know.
Well, I was talking about the original source you're building from, if you do multiple
versions. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
And then you have the PDB and you try to go out and find it, and then you extract the sources from
yes.
it.
Yes.
I know.
That's very interesting. You know, and this is just a prototype that we build, and we have it out on the web. You can download it and install it on top of VS 2012. When we ship 2013, we build the version for 2013 too. But, you know, this great feedback, right? Because we were thinking about should we connect it to source control, right? So they can go and eventually find the right source control, like you said, the right version of the freaking source file, right? You know, you know, we do it because it, for us it's easier because, you know, we compile, you know, Windows, for example, Windows source code. They don't really use VCX projects, right? You know, and so, you know, but they keep basically all the sources for like the last 3 weeks in service. So it's, for 3 weeks, you can just point to the right point, you know, when you know the version and so on. So, I mean, you know, or some complex project. Anyway, yeah. So, yeah, but anyway, you, again, you can explore, you know, you can go back and see, you know, how test is implemented, you know, and you see the bomb things, so you want to understand more about the bomb, you know, and, you know, there's going to be, you know, launch bomb, and you want to understand who's calling the launch bomb, because you really want to launch the bomb, but you don't know how to do that, you know, and so, you know, calls to launch bomb. There you go. That's it. And the keyboard, right? So you go here, and you know, and it's actually launched the bomb with the space. So let's launch the bombs, you know. But that's, you know, that would be, in my opinion, you know, a bunch of stuff that, you know. Again, I did this to show you. The bombs are pretty cool. These very angry birds. But, you know, again, you know, I want to show you a little bit, you know, how those little tools, you know, help you understand a little bit the core, right? Where we are in this situation that, you know, you don't have everything set up. You just want to be a little fast and kind of trying to figure out what's up, you know. Sometimes I search everything by, you know, leveraging, you know, final references, the call hierarchy and so on. It's pretty natural. The more you do it, you know, or, you know, the peak. We also have that feature that, you know, has a larger scroll box here. I don't know where it is, so it's too complicated for me. But yeah, so I show you Box2D, and you know, next I want to mix together Cinder and Box2D. Again, a very simple example, but you know, again, another thing I did, I put all Box2D that is not very large, again, the lib file and the header files in an extension SDK, so it's easier. So I'm gonna create a new project. What is that? A new project that is my usual Cinder basic app. You know, no, I don't say that. You know, that does the same things. And you know, the first thing I want to do is add reference. Actually, let's see. Right? You know, add a new reference and what is that? Extensions. And I have Box2D here because I put it there. It's not very complicated. You have to write a couple of XML files, throw a bunch of files in the right shape, and it's all documented online, or you just open one that you like and copy everything and change the names and the versions. It all works. Now, basically, I have Box2D compiling. Pretty easy. What do I want to do? I also, you know, Box2D is, you know, is a bit more, you know, complicated to use, you know, you have to set up the word, you have to change the word coordinates from your coordinates of your screen and so on. So the Cinder community wrote an interesting mini wrapper, you know, around Box2D to actually simplify this even more, right? It's already kind of simple, but these guys, they just want to go fast. So I copy this file and, you know, we can put it here. Let's open this. You know, and you know, if you add this, what is that? The existing item, what is that? B2 Cinder, blah, blah, blah. You know, now if we compile everything, that's, you know, we can, you know, include B2 Cinder dot H, and, you know, I think I'm going to also use some random stuff from Cinder, and you know, and I can using namespace CIB to box2D. There you go. You know, and right now, you know, I'm just gonna compile, and then, you know, we can think about, you know, what we can. What do I want to do? I forgot. Yes. Basically, I want to, you know, what's the key things here that. We don't need all this stuff again. The key things that this B2 Cinder gives you this sandbox. And basically, you know, and that's, you know, kind of, you know, basically a space where you control your objects, and then they have a gravity already set up, and they start going to fall down. If you add boxes inside the sandbox, they're going to fall down, and then you can move them around and interact with each other. And so that's pretty much what you do. You do in the setup, you know, you're going to do what you want to do. You know, you do sandboxing. Yeah, writing good? Yes. It, a little bit for intelligence to kick in. And, you know, I'm mouse move, I'm just going to pass it over to the sandbox. Mouse move. What do you? Yeah. I should copy so I don't have to type anymore. What's mouse move? Mouse move. And then, you know, stuff like that. Mouse drag. Well, there's no mouse move there. What was that? There's no mouse move. We don't care about mouse move. We care about mouse up and down. Up and down. Up. And then I'm going to fix up the other files, the declaration. Down. Sorry, you have to see me typing a little bit. Maybe I should just show you the things I did already. Oh, I should be almost done. Yeah. Anyway, maybe I should just show you my version that is here. So, where is that? This one here. So what I wanted to do here is the same. You know, if you see here, I just did the same mouse up, mouse down. I'm gonna push. Mouse up. And mouse down and mouse drag, I'm just going to push them to the sandbox. And in the update cycle, in the init cycle, in the setup basically, I just create 50 boxes and put them randomly somewhere and add some random color. And, you know, you create this, the position, add box just gets, you know, the position and the sides of the box and the color. And that's pretty much it, you know. And the update, you just pass it to the sandbox, and the draw, you just call the sandbox draw. This update cycle is actually going to do something. It's going to step the time forward, right? You know, all the simulation, the time is going to go forward, and all the boxes are going to move around. And it should work. You know, and this, again, you know, and it's complaints about a bunch of conversion. But... again, it's very composable. You know, you are adding this, you know, physics engine with a bunch of, you know, time information, and then you get all these colorful boxes, and you can grab them with your finger and move them around, you know. And, you know, how this works is, you know, there is really, you know, basically, there is, you're attaching a force, right? Your finger now is like a body, and there is a string attached to it. And that's why there is this elastic thing. And there is a certain force, and it's stronger than usually the rest of the gravity force and so on. So that's why you can pull it up. You know, you're stronger than the gravity, and you can pull up the things and simulate everything, right? But it's very, very simple, right? You know, like you say, it's very, very quick ramp up, and to do something that is, if you had to write everything by hand, of course, it's going to take forever, right? You know, and you have to, you know. I mean, like the Kalman filters, I guess. But, you know, so that's, you know, that's what's more or less, you know, what I want to show, I guess, you know. Yeah, I mean, just really about, you know, code understanding, simplicity, try to understand the code, try to leverage Visual Studio, and, you know, I have my presentation. You know, what's that? Oh, it's gonna get upset. Anyway, so it should be fine. So this is what we saw was really, we grabbed Cinder from the Windows Store from GitHub. We compiled and looked at our sample. We simplified the code and made it reusable so I can create new application over and over. You know, create a new project, added the pen support. That was pretty easy. Then we looked at the box2D sample, leveraging the PDB-based project there. And, we just kind of played around with this. And I don't know much about graphics. You know, I just saw someone playing around with this, and I just reconstructed the demo from there, right? I wanted to play around more with shaders and so on. But, you maybe don't need to get some interesting things to impress your kids, right? I hope I inspired you, really, to maybe, when I saw something like that, I said, wow, I want all my guys to do demos with this. I don't want to see command line demos anymore, right? But maybe a little bit too much. But, I really wanted to play with this. So, thanks for the opportunity also to share this. And I want to close about, I really care about this boundary, right? I really care about to hear from you, which is the boundary you care about, and, are you exploring some boundary? Are you doing, some adventure? Because I have fun with the language. The language is really elegant. It's, when I'm bored, when I have to do too many reviews or all the bullshit with you at work, I usually write code at night, and my wife thinks I'm crazy, but it's okay. But I try to look at these things that, they are not super important, right? So, any question? These are my two kids. I always put them for good luck in the presentations. So any question you have, and I have a bunch of resources here. So, this is the link to the PDB project. So if you want to try and let me know what, let us know what it is. These are my email and Eric's email that is gone. And the blog, That's pretty much it. No. I guess I'm going to give you the PowerPoint. Yeah, I guess so. Yes. So, yeah. Well, thanks. Oh, yeah, that's okay. Yeah.